can do anything. I can do all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible through you. Blind eyes are open, strongholds are broken. I am living by faith. Nothing is impossible. Come on, everybody, good morning. Put those hands together.
Next to him like a candle to the sun. forsaken for the sake of all mankind. Salvation is in His love. Jesus, Messiah, the righteous died for love. It was His number, for He is the risen one. This is my
Jesus, we come to meet with You this morning. let your praise cascade off my lips, oh God, my King. Invigorate my soul so I can praise you. Take me deeper.
Amen, amen. God is good, right? God is good. Well, hey, we're so excited to have you here at church this morning. My name is Ashley, and you better be real excited that you're here because you're not out running the marathon right now, right? It's a little chilly. It's raining. I actually was going to sign up to run it. I actually trained a smidge for it, and then I said, no, I'm good. I'm thankful I said that because it's a little chilly outside, so nobody got time for that. But hey, we're excited to have you here at Cornerstone, whether you're here joining us right here or you're in the gathering place or you're watching us online. We're just excited to have you. We're excited to have you here because we know that God is going to do something awesome in this place today. Amen? Amen. Well, hey, at Cornerstone, we partner with a ministry each month. And it just so happens that for the month of April, we're partnering with Vitamin Angels. And for every two check-ins on Facebook, anybody have a Facebook in here? Okay, a couple of you, the rest of you are lying. For those of you that have a Facebook, what I want you to do, I want you to check in to cornerstone.tv. And for every two check-ins, we are providing a year's worth of vitamins for a child in need. How awesome is that? How awesome. That was a really wimpy clap. I'm just gonna say, y'all better get it together. That's awesome. That's awesome. God is good, and we're touching lives right here in Midwest City, Oklahoma, around the world. So before we get into Pastor Dallas's message, because he's gonna bring it this morning, I've already listened to it. It's awesome. He's gonna bring it. We like to tell him, preach it, white boy. That's what we tell him, right? Preach it, white boy. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if he says something good during service, I want you to say that to him, okay? Or preach it or something. So before we get into that, though, what I want you to do, I want you to shake the hands of five new people. Are you ready? Set, go.
You can grab a seat. How's everybody doing this morning? That wasn't bad. It was better than first service. All right, how's everybody doing this morning? I know, sometimes you're like, it's been raining all weekend. You can imagine how I'm doing. How many of you, like, didn't leave the house, like, at all yesterday? Just, like, forget it. It's just, you know, Netflix kind of day. So, but, you know, I'm excited that you're at church this morning. Pastor Ron and Carol are out of town this morning, so they asked me to preach. Ushers, stop people at the doors. Don't let them leave. So, thank you for being here and for choosing to worship. Everybody watching at home that didn't want to get out in the rain, thank you for joining in as well. But I'm excited to be preaching this morning. I only get to preach on Sunday mornings a few times a year. And so when I do, it's always an honor for me. If you don't know who I am, my name is Dallas. Me and my wife are the youth pastors here. We've been here for 9.5 years, which is eternity in youth ministry world. But we love ministering to the teenagers. Thank you for those 8 woohoos. But we love ministering to the teenagers, and a lot of times you may not see us because we're down at Catalyst and taking care of the teenagers, and that's what we love doing. We love seeing their lives impacted for Jesus, and for all of you parents that trust us with your teenagers, it means a lot. We are truly honored to be able to minister to them. And this morning, I'm going to preach one of my sermons from a series we did just a few months ago entitled Legacy. Everybody say Legacy. And we talked about 3 different ways we leave a legacy. And the first way that we leave a legacy is by how we serve. And when at the beginning of this year, I just really prayed and I said, God, what do you have new for the youth ministry this year? Every year I pray, God, give me a new direction, or God, give me something. And this year I really felt like God clearly told me to make this year a year where we serve and we do outreaches and we do ministry and do outreaches that benefit Catalyst Zero. Everybody say zero. And the purpose of that is I want our teenagers ministering and serving others without it like having any quote-unquote benefit to the ministry at Catalyst. It only benefits them to serve. Does that make sense? And so just a month and a half ago or so, we took about 50 teenagers and we just went and served the homeless in downtown Oklahoma City. And we have several other events lined up throughout this year because that's an emphasis for us this year. How many of you agree that that's a great thing to get our teenagers selflessly serving? huge, and we are excited to do that. So the first way we leave a legacy is by how we serve. The second way we leave a legacy is by how we live. Every day, everywhere we go, people are watching the words we say, the actions that we're doing, and they're watching us to see if we're legit, if we're real, and we leave a legacy by that. My parents left a legacy and instilled a legacy in me. Every single one of you parents, you're leaving a legacy behind in your kids' lives. They're watching you. They're constantly watching you. Any of your kids ever see you do something that you didn't want them to see you doing, and you're like, oh, I didn't know you saw me throw that skillet across the room. All right. You know, they're watching you, and we're leaving a legacy by our actions and the way we carry ourselves. And the third way we leave a legacy, and that's what I'm going to be talking about this morning, is we leave a legacy by how we pray. Everybody say pray. And we're going to be talking about legacy prayers this morning. And my prayer is that it challenges you and it causes you to think a little bit differently about prayer. When God, when I was asked to preach, I kind of started, you know, praying and thinking about God, what do you want me to share? And it really, for me, I kind of kept coming back to this message, and it kind of scared me because I'm like, Pastor Ron is such a good teacher on prayer, and he preaches on it a lot. But how many of you realize we're the body of Christ? And your hand has a different function than your knee. How many of you realize that? And so, some of you don't, but it's okay. You'll wake up in a second. We all have different functions, and Pastor Ron, the way he teaches on prayer is great, and I'm going to teach it a different way, and so hopefully you get different things out of this, but I understand that God has spoken this to me, and I feel like it'll really bless you, and so I'm going to be talking about legacy prayers. Leonard Ravenhill said this, preaching moves man, but prayer moves God. When you pray and you get on your knees, or maybe you're not literally on your knees, but when you're praying, you are touching God Almighty. The God that created the entire universe is hearing your prayers. And I know all of you know that, but let that sink in for a second. When you pray, God Almighty is hearing you. Somebody say amen. That's a big deal. And sometimes we take it for granted, and we just, you know, just if we're not careful, prayer becomes very routine. And it's just something that we do all the time. It shouldn't be that way. In Psalms chapter 37, verse 3, it says, trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you your heart's desires. Commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust him, and he will help you. Let's pray over the service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you so much that we can gather together this morning and worship you. God, we thank you for what you've already done in our hearts as we've just worshiped and praised you, God. But I pray during this time as we get into the word, God, that you speak to every single person in here. God, I know that you gave this message to me, God, and I pray that it ministers to everybody. If there is something in this message that you don't want me to say, God, I pray that you just stop it. God, and if there's something you want me to add, God, I pray that you just speak that to me, God. And I thank you that it's not an accident that every single person, whether in this room or watching online, God, that they're listening to this message. God, you have a word for them. God, and I thank you that we have ears to hear it. In Jesus' name. And everybody said? And everybody said? Amen. So, I know that many times when it comes to prayer, we kind of have our routines, we kind of have our habits when it comes to prayer, but I want to go back to this, and I want to talk about how we leave legacy prayers, but the first thing we got to understand is that God is a good God. Can everybody say amen to that? This is probably one of the things that bothers me the most about theology and Christianity today is that for some reason, somewhere throughout our timeline as a church, we started basically intimidating people into believing that God was not good and that God was not loving, and we did it primarily to scare people into a relationship with God, and I understand how that theology crept in, but the Bible is very clear that God loves his children. Can somebody say amen? God wants to be a good father. He wants to take care of us. So if you look at Psalms 37, verse 3, it says, trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. So God wants us to be safe, and he wants us to prosper. Verse 4, take delight in the Lord, and he will give you your heart's desires. God wants to give you your heart's desires. In verse 5, commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust him, and he will help you. How many of you need God's help in your life? Some of you need both hands. You need a lot of help. We need God's help in our lives, but God wants to give us these things. He's very clear that he wants to do that, and so we have to understand the first question that we have to answer in each and every one of our hearts is, does God want to answer my prayers? And the answer to that is yes, yes, and yes. God wants to answer your prayers. There's some stipulations that we're going to get into in a second about the way we pray, but God wants to answer your prayers. If you look at Matthew chapter 7, it says, ask and you will receive, Search and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened for you. Everyone who asks will receive. Everyone who searches will find. And the door will be open for everyone who knocks. Verse 9, would any of you give your hungry child a stone if the child asks for some bread? Some of us might as a joke, but eventually we're going to give them bread, right? Would you give your child a snake if your child asks for a fish? I love this verse in verse 11. As bad as you are, you still know how to give good gifts to your children. But your heavenly Father is even more ready to give good things to people who ask. Everybody say, wow. That is God basically saying, I want to give you these things. You got to ask. And as we get into this message, I think a lot of times people don't ask because they're scared they're going to do it wrong. How many of you have ever felt that way in prayer? Like, I want to pray and ask God for something, but I don't want to mess up. Did anybody else in here grow up in homes that prayed really eloquent prayers? Anybody have like grandparents or parents that, you know, they when they prayed, you're like, oh yeah, God definitely heard that one. That was good. That was standing ovation. Like, that was good stuff. I was a pastor's kid. And so my dad used to wake up at 5 a.m. every morning. We had a little office off to the side of our house. And he would go in there and literally like just, he was a loud prayer. Anybody have family members that prayed loud? Like they wanted to make sure the neighbors heard him praying. That was my dad. And so he would go in there and he would just pray. And I mean, you know, paint's coming off the walls. He's binding and loosing and, you know, all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, you know, 9 years old. And I'm like, God, good morning. You know, I felt very intimidated to pray because I grew up around a family that they knew how to pray. And that's not a bad thing, obviously, but they knew how to pray. And so many times I was intimidated to pray because I was like, I'm not going to do it right, or I'm not going to do it good enough. And we have to eliminate that thought in our mind that says, I'm not good enough to pray. All of us are good enough to pray. We are children of God. Andrew Womack says, the heart attitude behind your prayers interests God much more than the actual words you say. Come on. If my kid comes to me and says, Dad, I want a cookie, I'm not listening to how they ask it necessarily. I'm asking to their heart behind it. If my kid comes up to me and is like, hey, Dad, give me a cookie. I'm like, get out of here. Hey, Dad, I did all the chores. Is there any way I could have a cookie? I mean, their heart behind it means a lot more to me than, oh, Father, you wonderful Father. I'm so thankful to have you as a Father. I can't even begin to describe all the wonderful things you've done for me, Father. I'd be like, what are you doing? What do you want? This is weird. I'm more interested in their heart behind it than the actual words they say. And so when we go to God in prayer, pray it just like you would talk to your spouse or a friend, just like, hey, I need this. I'm praying for this. I'm believing for this. And just be real. And so does God want to answer your prayers? Yes, absolutely. Next thing is, are you always going to feel God in prayer? No. Sometimes I like pray prayers and I'm like, God Almighty is in this room right now. Like, y'all remember that old song, I Can Feel the Presence of, you know, I mean, like you're like, Moses, I need to take off my shoes. God is in my living room right now. And then there's other times where I'm like, mic check, God, are you listening? Hello, hello. You just don't necessarily feel it. How many of you are here, about a month or two ago, we had a night of worship and prayer here at Cornerstone. How many of you were here for that? Give me a woohoo if you were here. Because it was good. Anyways, so Pastor Colt asked some of the pastors to come up and pray. And I don't remember what I was supposed to pray for, but I remember, like, as I'm praying, God just kind of took a detour and I just kind of went for it. You know what I'm saying? And I like felt God all over me. And it was just like, I mean, I don't know about you, but when I feel God in my life when I'm praying, I get louder and louder. Anybody else like that? And so I started off kind of normal. And then by the end, I'm like, hey, God, we thank you. You know, I was excited. You know, I'm a little bit hyper anyways, but when I get hyper in prayer, it's a whole nother level. And so I'm just going for it. And I felt God's presence all over me. If the devil had walked up to me in that exact moment, I would have punched him. You know, I mean, it was like, it's going to turn into a knockout moment. You know, it's like, God is on me. Hairs are standing up, you know, goosebumps or God bumps, whatever you want to call them. I'm like, God is here. But then there's those moments where you're praying and you're just like, God, I'm believing for this. And you just feel nothing. That doesn't make praying to God Almighty any less important or any less real. You are still praying prayers to God. And we can't let our feelings get in the way. I remember the end of January of the year 2000, I proposed to my wife. She said yes, thank God. But I'd had the ring for about 3 months. And I was one of those guys. Now, everyone's got a different proposal story. I know some of you are just like, so, you want to get married? I get that. There's That's yours and your wife's story. Me, I was like, I really want this really cool moment, but I could not think of a really cool moment. And so I just kept hanging on to the ring until something came to mind. So the end of January of the year 2000, some of you may remember, I was living in Tulsa going to Bible school, but we had a huge snowstorm, like 18 inches of snow, just dumped on us. And I was like, light bulb moment, I got it. I was like, this is going to be amazing. And so we lived about half a mile, three quarters of a mile from the river in Tulsa. We lived off of Lewis or whatever. And I was like, I can get down there and I'll propose to her in this huge blizzard. It's going to be beautiful right beside the river. It's going to be awesome. And so my roommate helped me. We had nothing better to do. We were snowed in. And so we slid in the car. We got to Walmart and we got 20 or 30 of those long candles. Y'all know what I'm talking about? I don't know what they're called. There's a name for them. But the ones that are like a foot, 2 foot long. And we went out into the middle of this spot right beside the river, and I made this heart shape out of all these candles. I know. I'm going to get brownie points for this later. And so then I took a couple camping chairs, and I took my guitar, and my buddy, my roommate, he was like, all right, I'll guard everything till you get back, you know. And so he watched everything, and I went and got Tia, and I mean, it's a snow day. She didn't have makeup on. And I was like, all right, babe, get ready. We're going somewhere. She's like, what? And I was like, you don't have good shoes. Get some like trash bags. And I like duct taped trash bags all the way up to her knees. It was romantic. And I take her down there, take her to the river, and I blindfold her so she didn't know where we're going. So we're going through 18 inches of snow. And I mean, it sounded a lot better in my mind than it was in actual reality. It was miserable. She's getting mad because, snow's getting everywhere. And so finally we get her to this spot, and I sit her down, and I keep her blindfolded. I'm lighting all the candles, and then I pull out my guitar, and I'm like, all right, take your blindfold off. And I start singing to her. Everybody say, aw. Y'all remember that song or that movie, The Wedding Singer? Remember at the end of the movie when he says, I want to grow old with you, that song? All right, I'm cheesy. So I literally sang that to her, and then I proposed. It was awesome. And then afterwards, I told her I love you. And it was just that moment where you could all feel it. And it was like, it was amazing. But then there's those moments where I tell her I love her after I've done the dishes. And sometimes that means just as much. Women, can you say amen? And the reason I say that is because when I tell my wife I love her, whether it was right after I proposed or right after I took out the trash, it still means the same. I still am showing her I love her, but the emotions or the feelings may or may not be there quite as much. It's the same way with God in prayer. It doesn't matter if you're feeling God, because I think so many times we feel like when we pray, if we don't feel it, God's not there, and that's just simply not true. God is always there. He sees everything you're going through, and he hears every prayer that you prayed. So what is a legacy prayer? I tried to put this into words, but it's kind of difficult, and I'll explain why in a second. But the best way I could describe it, what a legacy prayer is selfless. And it's not about meeting your immediate needs. It's about making an impact on your world. Here's what I mean by that. A legacy prayer is not so much, God, where's my car keys? I'm late for work. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with praying that prayer. I think we've all prayed that prayer at some point in our life. Anybody ever find your car keys in the most random spot? How did they end up in the freezer? I don't understand. Sometimes it just happens. But what I mean by a legacy prayer is it's a selfless prayer that is not just taking care of your immediate needs, but it's into the future. If I could describe it like this, if you wanted to leave a legacy for your family or for the people around you in five different areas, if I were to tell you, write down five legacies you want to leave in your life right now, and you were to write them down, what would they be? Now, what if you only had five prayers left to pray your entire life? It'd probably be pretty smart to not pray over where your car keys are, right? But you would start praying those five legacies because that's what you want to last, something that's going to last into the future, something that's going to make an impact on your world. So I want to ask you to begin to pray over those areas. Some of the examples of legacies, it could be praying over unsaved loved ones. Say, God, I'm praying them into the kingdom. There's hardly a better thing you can pray for than praying that someone will receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Can somebody say amen? That's a legacy prayer. And I know several of you have parents, you have siblings, you have people that are very close to you, maybe children that are not living for the Lord. And that's a huge legacy prayer you need to pray. I have a 9-year-old daughter and a 12, about to be 13 next week, year old daughter. You know what I pray for them all the time? For their future and their future spouses. I know that's scary, but you know what? It's a lot scarier to not pray over those future spouses. I am not excited about my children getting married someday, mainly because they're girls and I'm going to have to pay for the wedding. But And because boys are boys. And it scares me as a dad because I know. And but I pray over their spouses because I want them to be married to godly men who show my daughters respect and love and respect their father-in-laws a lot. And I pray over them. That's a legacy prayer. Another legacy prayer is over the health of your family. God, you take care of my children. You take care of my spouse. You take care. Pray over that. Pray over safety over your family. Pray over your church. That's a legacy prayer because God is impacting people every single week right here at this church. Can somebody say amen? You know, a lot of times we think of legacies and we think of a legacy as almost like a will. Like that's the money you pass down or something like that. You know, my parents are pastors, and as far as I know, they're not millionaires because they don't act like it. And I'm pretty sure, unless there's something I'm not aware of, they're not going to be passing down millions of dollars when they pass away someday far in the future in Jesus' name. But you know what? They have left a legacy in my life in so many different areas. I'm up here this morning preaching because they deposited a legacy of a love for God, a love for God's word, and a love for ministry. I am part of their legacy that every single week I'm up, that I'm ministering to people. That's a legacy my parents put in me, a desire to help people and a desire to be a minister. There's so many different areas that we can leave a legacy beyond just the good things we pass down to our kids. Well, I'm leaving them this land. I'm leaving them this money. No, we can leave a legacy by what we deposit in the people around us. And I think that's hugely important. We need to pray over those areas. So I want to talk about three keys to answered prayer this morning. Three keys to answered prayer. Number one is this: go to war. Everybody say war. Oh, that was weak. Everybody say war. I like response and feedback here, so if y'all can't tell. Go to war. You got to get serious when you're praying and asking God for something and not just kind of like casually throwing it out there. So many times we get into almost routines and bad habits when it comes to prayer. Everybody bow your head. We're going to pray over our food differently. Father God, bless us with the nourishment of our body. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, it's like an auctioneer. And green beans and casserole and sold. I mean, what are we doing? It's a time where we get to thank God for something. And we need to slow it down and remember when we're praying, we're talking to God. Most people think of prayer as basically this big joke or just this something that's just kind of routine or a habit, and they don't really take it serious. And a great example of this, if I ever find a better illustration of this, I'll use it. But a great example of people not taking prayer very seriously is this clip. Y'all check it out.
Dear Lord Baby Jesus, or as our brothers to the south call you, Jesus, we thank you so much for this bountiful harvest of Domino's, KFC, and the always delicious Taco Bell. I just want to take time to say thank you for my family, my two beautiful, beautiful, handsome, striking sons, Walker and Texas Ranger, or TR as we call them. And, of course, my red-hot smoking wife, Carly, who is a stone-cold fox. Also want to thank you for my best friend and teammate, Cal Naughton Jr., who's got my back no matter what.
Shake and bake.
Dear Lord Baby Jesus, we also thank you for my wife's father, Chip. We hope that you can use your Baby Jesus powers to heal him and his horrible leg. And it smells terrible, and the dogs are always bothering with it. Dear tiny infant Jesus.
Sweetie, Jesus did grow up. You don't always have to call him baby. It's a bit odd and off-putting to pray to a baby.
Well, look, I like the Christmas Jesus best, and I'm saying grace. When you say grace, you can say it to grown-up Jesus or teenage Jesus or bearded Jesus or whoever you want.
You know what I want? I want you to do this grace good so that God will let us win tomorrow.
Dear tiny Jesus, your golden fleece diapers with your tiny little fat balled-up fist pawing.
He was a man. He had a beard.
Look, I like the baby version the best. Do you hear me? I win the races and I get the money.
Ricky, finish the race.
I like to picture Jesus in a tuxedo t-shirt because it says, like, I want to be formal, but I'm here to party, too. Because I like to party, so I like my Jesus to party.
I like to picture Jesus as a ninja fighting off evil samurai.
I like to think of Jesus, like, with giant eagle's wings and singing lead vocals for Leonard Skinner with like an angel band, and I'm in the front row.
Hey, Cal.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Dear 8-pound, 6-ounce, newborn infant Jesus. Don't even know a word yet. Just a little infant, so cuddly, but still omnipotent. Mm. We just thank you for all the races I've won and the $21.2 million. Woo!
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 Ow!
Love that money that I have accrued over this past season. Also, due to a binding endorsement contract that stipulates I mention Powerade at each grace, I just want to say that Powerade is delicious, and it cools you off on a hot summer day. And we look forward to Powerade's release of Mystic Mountain Blueberry. Thank you for all your power and your grace, dear baby God. Amen.
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 I don't really know how to respond to that video. I'm sure many of you have seen that. And I think that's a great example of people that are not taking a prayer very serious. Am I right? But you know, hopefully you're not that bad. Jesus' name. But if we're not careful, many times we get into these habits of just kind of sort of taking prayer seriously, and we just kind of flippantly throw out prayers that we're not putting our heart behind. The first key to answered prayer, I said, was go to war. I want to give you a couple tips on how to go to war. And the first one is this: speak it out. Speak out what you're wanting God to do in your life. Everybody turn to your neighbor. Everybody find a neighbor or find a partner. And stick out your hand to them and grab their four fingers and leave your thumb up. And here we go, everybody. One, two, three, four. I declare a what? A thumb war. All right, you can finish it or not. I'm a youth pastor. I'm used to thumb wars during service. It's okay. We have way worse than thumb wars that happen while I'm preaching. Not going to bother me. But one, two, three, four, I declare a thumb war. When we go to God in prayer, sometimes we have got to declare war with the devil. We've got to draw a line in the sand that says, hey, punk, I'm aware that you've been in charge in this area of my life, but no more. I declare war in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen? We go to war with the devil, and we got to speak it out. We got to say what we're believing for. Many times it's almost like we have this wishful thinking mentality when it comes to prayer. Like, well, God knows what I want. I mean, God sees what I'm believing for. Why do I have to say it? There is power in our words, and I didn't write the Bible, and I don't understand all of it, but I do know it says there is power in our words. And when we speak something out, something changes in the spiritual realm, and God begins to act on our behalf. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Speak it out. Say it. What are you believing for? Say it out loud. God, I'm believing that you're going to do this in my life. You know, I don't know about you, but I have children who don't always behave perfectly. I don't know. Maybe it's just us. We have, they're wonderful children, but every now and then we walk into their rooms and it looks like they grabbed all their toys and just flung them everywhere to see what kind of art piece they could create on the floor. And rarely do we walk in the rooms and find one of our children, hey, Dad, I know it means a lot to you, so I went ahead and cleaned my room. You're welcome. It may have happened. I'm not saying it hasn't. I don't want to lie while I'm on stage preaching, but I'm pretty sure it hasn't. Maybe it has. I don't know. But you know what has happened? I've walked in the rooms many times and said, hey, I'd really need you to clean this room. Would you please take care of cleaning this room for me? Thank you. Love you. And what happens then? The room starts getting some attention. Sometimes I have to ask more than once, but that's a whole nother sermon. But you know, when I vocalize and when I speak it out, this is what I need from you, that's when something begins to change. And the same is true with God. Many times we just assume that God knows what we're believing for, but you know what? We need to speak it out. We need to pray it. Even Jesus prayed, and he prayed what he was believing for. It's Jesus, and he was speaking it out and telling God what he was believing for. So the first component of going to war is we got to speak it out. The second component of going to war is we got to speak the word. Everybody say the word. How many of you have your Bible with you, on your phone, on your iPad, or a literal Bible? Congrats if you got literal Bibles. Way to go. But we have, that is God's word. We got to speak it out. We can't just say, all right, Pastor Dallas said three keys to answer prayer. I'm going to war. God, I pray that you strike my neighbor down. No, that's not God's word. I don't care how loud their dogs are and they're annoying you, you know. We can't pray prayers that don't line up with God's word.
In 1 John chapter 5, verse 14, it says, "This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have, we know that we have what we asked of him." Sorry about that. So what is the middle of that verse says? It says, according to his will. According to his will. What is his will? His word. When you're praying for something, find a scripture on it. Don't just assume it's in the word of God. Well, I mean, I'm sure God wants for my family to behave themselves. Those children to get in line. So God, I pray that my family acts normal and sane. Nothing wrong with that prayer. Find a scripture that backs it up. Nothing wrong with praying for finances in your home. Find a scripture that backs it up. Nothing wrong with praying health over your family. Find a scripture that backs it up. Because when you begin to speak it out, you need to speak God's word. Because what does God say? He's going to answer those prayers that are prayed what? According to his will. And we have to pray those prayers that are according to God's will. The second key to answered prayer is this. Don't quit. In 1 Kings chapter 18, it tells the story of Elijah. And how many of you remember the story of Elijah when he challenged the prophets of Baal to a duel at the top of the mountain? How many of you remember that story? And so the prophets of Baal, they're like, "Our God's the real God." And Elijah's like, "No, idiots, my God is the real God, God Almighty." And so they get up there on this thing, and they have this challenge. And they're like, they build these altars, and they're like, "Whichever God comes down with fire and consumes the sacrifice, that's the real God." And Elijah's like, "All right." So these prophets of Baal, they're like walking around chanting, and they start, you know, doing this stuff. And Elijah starts taunting them. He's like, "A little louder, maybe your God's asleep." I mean, it's a great scripture if you haven't read it, 1 Kings 18. And so finally, they start cutting themselves, and it's just not going well. Nothing happens. Blah, nothing. And so then Elijah gets up there and he says, "You know what? Just for fun, why don't you get a bunch of buckets of water and just drench my sacrifice, make it even more difficult." Now, that's also another miracle because they were in the middle of a drought. So it was like doing that was like, you know, a big deal. But they drench his sacrifice. And then, of course, he calls on God. Fire comes down from heaven, burns it up. It's an amazing miracle. But before that, in verse 1 of 1 Kings 18, verse 1 and 2, God told Elijah to go and meet these prophets. And he said, "And when you do, after that, I'm going to send rain. The drought's going to be over." It had not rained for 3.5 years. That's a long time. 3.5 years, it had not rained. And so if you go down to verse 18, it says, "King Ahab left, but Elijah climbed back to the top of Mount Carmel, and then he stooped down with his face almost to the ground, and he said to his servant, 'Look toward the sea.' And the servant left, and when he came back, he said, 'I looked, but I didn't see anything.' And Elijah told him to look 7 more times. How many of you realize if someone tells you, "Hey, go look outside and see if you see anything," and you come back 7 times, how many of you are going to be getting pretty annoyed at your boss who keeps telling you to do that? Like, "Dude, you better be paying me overtime for this. This is ridiculous." But 7 times he tells him to do that. Verse 44, "After the 7th time, the servant replied, 'I see a small cloud coming this way, but it's no bigger than a fist.' And Elijah told him, 'Tell Ahab to get his chariot ready and start home now. Otherwise, the rain is going to stop him.' A few minutes later, it got very cloudy and windy, and rain started pouring down." Somebody say amen. Why did Elijah keep telling his servant to go look for that cloud, to go look for rain? When it hadn't rained in 3.5 years, God had told him it was going to rain. The drought was going to end. God had already spoken that to him, and so he knew what he could stand on. He knew what he was believing for because God had already spoken it to him. What has God spoken to you in his word about the promises you can stand on and you can believe for? Second point is just don't quit. Don't quit believing for those. Doesn't matter if you don't see it immediately. "Well, Pastor Dallas, God promised me healing. I've been praying for it and I haven't seen it yet." Don't quit. Keep believing. Keep believing that God's going to bring that to pass. And then the third key to answered prayer is this. Remain thankful. Remain thankful. Do you remember the scripture in the Bible, the story in the Bible where Jesus was walking along one day and 10 lepers come up to him and they said, "Jesus, can you heal us?" And Jesus said, "Go show yourself to the priest and you will be healed." And they turned around, they went, and on their way to the priest, they all got completely healed. And one of them, everybody say one, came back to Jesus and said, "Thank you so much, I'm healed." And Jesus said, "Wasn't there 10? Why did only one come back?" You know, it's sad, but a lot of times we get our miracle and we get our answer from God, and we forget where it came from. We're like, "Yes, I got a raise. Yes, my kids are healthy. Yes, whatever." And we forget to go to God and say, God, thank you. I've been believing for that. And I know it wasn't about me. It was about you. You know, I heard a sermon very, very similar to this when I was just a young kid, and it was about being thankful. And I determined right then and there that for the rest of my life, whenever God did something for me, I was going to stop immediately to thank God. How many of you have bad memories like me? Anybody? Just you forget things? Some of you don't even remember that you have a bad memory. You're like, I don't remember. You're like Dory, you know. Why? What am I doing here? But, you know, I know if God gives me a miracle, if I don't stop right then and there and pray and thank God, I'm going to forget about it. And so that's what I've done. Just say, God, I'm thankful. There's several reasons that people don't receive their answer to prayer. And the first one is this: spiritual attacks, so people quit believing. When you pray and you ask God for something, guess what? You're vocalizing it out, and guess who hears you? God hears you, but so does the devil. And the devil is not excited about it. Oh, they're believing for their family to be saved. That is wonderful. Good for Bobby. He's praying for Sally to be saved. The devil's not going to do that. He's immediately going to come attack. And so understand this. The attacks are going to come, but don't quit believing and don't quit standing in faith for that. And then the second reason why people sometimes don't have answered prayers is a lack of faith, or maybe a ceased faith, or they did have faith, but they quit believing because problems came. You know, you have to establish in your heart 100% God wants to do whatever you're believing for. And when you have that, it builds faith on the inside of you that says, our miracle's going to come just like Elijah. I want to close with the story of a young man that I was his youth pastor probably 12 years ago. And he had a pretty cool story. And I asked him one day to write it down and to email it to me because I love this story and I wanted to make sure I get it right. It's a little bit long, but I'm going to ask you, stay with me, and then we're going to close. His name is Michael Gonzalez, and he wrote, I was 9 years old, and I'd been going to church at a Catholic church for a long time. My dad was an alcoholic whose family suffered because of the bad habit that he could not get rid of. I remember walking to school because my dad would be gone for days with our car, and my mom would have to jump through hoops and make promises to family to get them to help us to where we needed to go. We would eat the same things over and over again because of the lack of finances. It wasn't that we were dirt poor, it was that my dad would use all of our money for his habits. I remember the long nights when we would leave and I could hear my mom crying herself to sleep, promising that she was never going to let him back in the house or go out and pick him up whenever he was, wherever he was, no matter what state he was in. But she loved him so much, she would find herself worried about where he was, hoping that he was okay. I just remember hugging my mom at night to try and get her to stop crying. But the pain was not going to be something that I could get rid of. There had to be something bigger. As for me, it was like my dad was my best friend during the day, but at night he turned into someone that would just bring hurt into my life and pain into my mother's. I remember being taught at CCD the Lord's Prayer. I memorized it, praying it daily. I didn't know that you could really talk to God other than saying those prayers. Never really was exposed to the idea that prayer was that real, where you could say what was on your heart. I decided that I was going to begin to pray for my dad, the Lord's Prayer, that is, since that's all that I knew. I remember my dad coming in at all hours of the night, and I remember him talking to himself, sweating and throwing up in the restroom. It wasn't pretty. My dad always loved foot massages since he was on his feet all the time at work. Knowing that he would accept a foot massage, I began to do that as much as I could when he would come in at night, and I would pray the Lord's Prayer over and over and over, thinking that the more I prayed it, the more it would work. And I remember asking God to please change my dad because I loved him so much. And I knew my mom loved him so much, so I prayed and prayed and prayed. God, please, I'm begging you, help my dad, is what I remember clearly. Then one day he woke up after a long night of his habit, and he was different. I know it sounds crazy, but that's how it happened. I later came to find out that he got on his knees after coming in that night in the shower, and he told God that if he didn't change him, he was going to take his own life because he could not live like that anymore. He had tried multiple times to stop drinking because of the pain he inflicted on us, but that never worked. After he prayed to God in the shower, he was made a new person. Now I believe that prayer is the key to the kingdom of heaven. Jesus was Jesus, and even he prayed. Because of the power of prayer, my dad, who was lost, is now found and has reached so many lives and is still doing so today. Can somebody say amen? That man is one of my good friends. His name is Enrique Gonzalez, and he is a pastor down in South Texas. That's where we're going on our mission trip this summer. We went there last summer, And many of these teenagers got to experience the ministry that this man has built. He's been a missionary all over Mexico, and now he's a pastor down in South Texas and doing amazing things for God. But you know, I love that story because it's not the normal prayers of a 9-year-old boy who says, God, give me a new video game. God, give me a Twix bar. God, give me a girlfriend. You know what it is? It's a 9-year-old boy praying a legacy prayer that has outlived those selfish desires, and he prayed a prayer that has changed the lives of many people, myself and our teenagers included. Because a 9-year-old boy got on his knees and prayed and believed God for something bigger. God is doing amazing ministry through him. And that 9-year-old boy is now the worship leader at that church and helps and is doing amazing things for God as well. Would everyone bow your head and close your eyes with me? I know many of you in this room, you have different things going on in your life. For me to try to narrow down what a legacy prayer is to fit your life is difficult because one of them was that your family would be saved. Maybe all your family is saved. One of them is praying health over your family. Maybe your family's healthy, but maybe you need to pray for the future of the health of your family. Maybe you don't have any children, so praying over your future spouses, that's not applicable. But what are some areas of your life that you want to leave a legacy in prayer that you are praying for your future? Maybe it's praying for your country. Maybe it's praying for your church, for your spouse, for finances, so that God can use you to reach people. This morning, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to ask a question. And it could literally be every single person in here. I understand that it might be kind of a generic question, but at the same time, I want you to sincerely answer it because when we talked a lot about faith this morning, when we join our faith with God and when we vocalize it, you raising your hands in just a moment is like that point of speak it out. You're declaring war on the enemy that says, no more. I'm drawing a line in the sand, and devil, you cannot have control over this area of my life any further. But if that's you this morning, you say, you know what, Pastor Dallas, I got some legacy prayers I need to pray in my life. And only you know what they are, but we're going to all join together in faith. But if you know what those legacy prayers, or you have a couple in your heart right now that you want to join in prayer with, if that's you, would you just slip up your hand so we can all pray together? I'm sure it's most of us have some big, big prayers that we need to pray. I know last week Pastor preached on stake your claim. And some of you may have written those down, some of these legacy prayers on that stake. Some of you have a blank stake at home. Write it down. Fill it out. Pray some legacy prayers on that stake that God is going to use to impact your future. Dearly Father God, I pray over every single person that raised their hand this morning, God, that they need to pray some legacy prayers over their family, over their finances, over their health, over the nation, over this church. God, whatever area, God, that you're leading them, God, I pray that they put their faith, God, that they don't quit standing. They don't quit believing, God. I pray that they go to war and they draw a line in the sand that says, devil, no more. That they pray some legacy prayers that outlive tomorrow, that they're bigger than just the right now and the immediate need, God, but they're thinking about ways they're going to leave a legacy in how they pray and in areas that they need victory over. And God, I thank you that we don't quit believing you for these miracles, God, that we know that you're going to bring them in Jesus' name. With every head still bowed and every eye closed, I never want to end a service without giving every single person an opportunity to meet Jesus. You see, God sent his son 2,000 years ago to die on the cross for our sins. And he did it so that we could have a relationship with God, so that we could have a path to get to heaven. Because if we were to walk into heaven right now without Jesus standing with us, we would not be accepted because we are sinful and there's no sin in heaven. But what happens is when we accept Jesus into our lives, it's like he becomes our proxy. He becomes our fill-in. He becomes our substitute. So when God looks at us, he doesn't see a sinful person like myself. He sees his son. Because God's gift of his son dying on the cross, his blood covered all of our sins. God doesn't see that sin anymore. But we have a responsibility to accept that gift of his son. If you're here this morning and you have never prayed that prayer, you have never accepted Jesus Christ into your life, I would be so honored to pray with you. If that's you, I'm not going to call you forward or ask you to stand, but I would just ask if you would just raise your hand so that I know who I'm praying for right now. Is there anybody here? Anybody here? You just need to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior this morning. Awesome. Dear me, Father God, I thank you for every single person that's here this morning. God, I thank you that when we hear the word, God, that it does something on the inside of us. God, I pray that you increase our faith, you increase our desire to pray, God, and that we pray some big prayers. God, that we throw it out there, God, because we know that you are faithful. God, I thank you for every single person struggling in their faith this morning. God, feeling like, well, I have prayed and I haven't seen the answer. Satan, I bind you and I rebuke you from attacking their mind with doubt and unbelief. God, we thank you that you are way bigger, God, than any of these temporary circumstances or setbacks the devil may try to throw at us. God, we thank you for the service this morning in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Pastor Dallas. It's time to start praying some legacy prayers, right? Yeah. Well, hey, so we're getting ready to take up tithes and offerings, but before we do that, I want to tell you a little bit about what's happening here. Mother's Day is coming up. Did you guys know that? It's coming up. And so if you haven't got anything for your wife or your mom, you have time because it's May 14th. But here at Cornerstone, we want to recognize all our moms out there. We know that you guys work so stinking hard. Whether you've got kids in your house or whether you're an empty nester, we know that you have either are doing your time or you've already done your time, but not in a good way, of course, in a good way, of course. But we want to recognize you. So over the next couple of weeks, we want you to post a video. Let me tell you about this. We're giving away two baskets, okay? And it's called My Mother is More Than Enough $500 Gift Basket. And how your mom or wife gets entered into this drawing for these baskets is you, dad, or maybe your kids, if they're old enough to explain why they think their mom deserves this gift basket. We want you to video that, a 30-second video or less. We want you to post it to Facebook. A couple reasons why we want you to post it to Facebook. One, because we want you to tag Cornerstone Church in it so we can see your video, okay? And number two, we think that all of your friends need to know how awesome your mom is or how awesome your wife is, right? I think one day out of the year is just not enough to appreciate our moms and what they've done for us. So what we want you to do, you've got this whole week to do that, and then you've got all the way until the 10th. So the 10th is a Wednesday, so make sure you post your video, 30 seconds or less, of why you believe your mom or your wife deserves this gift basket, because we want to pamper them, okay? So make sure you do that. Put on your calendars. Don't forget. Cool? Capiche? Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, hopefully by now you've got your tithes and offerings out, so we're going to pray over that. God, we love you and we thank you so much for all that you do. God, thank you that we get to be here today and worship you and learn about how to pray these legacy prayers. God, I pray today, Lord, that we are leaving different than when we came in the door, that Satan is scared that we just heard this message today because we're going to war. And God, I thank you for the seeds that are being sown right now. God, that they're not just going to stay in the walls of this Cornerstone Church, but they're reaching out in our community and around the world. And God, thank you that we get to be part of that ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. Sorry, don't play them yet. Don't play the announcements. I forgot one thing. How many of you were here a couple of months ago when we had the worship night? Anybody? Pastor Dallas mentioned it a few minutes ago, but we are having another worship night next Sunday, May 7th at 6 p.m. See, that's confusing. May 7th at 6 p.m. You want to be here. It's going to be awesome. God is going to move. Come expecting. We hope to see you guys there. Check out these announcements.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alethea. If you're our guest today, we'd love to get to know you. Please take a moment to text the word hello to 405-266-2242. You can also fill out the information card in your bulletin. Drop it off at our Connection Center, and one of our volunteers will give you a special gift just for being our guest. For everyone else, don't forget to check in on Facebook and tell all your friends about what God is doing at your church. There's always something happening around here, so give us just a minute to fill you in.
Cornerstone Kids is hosting a Parents Night on May 12th at 7 p.m., where we will be teaching you how to parent God's way. I encourage you to invest in your families and be a part of this fun night. Child care will be provided for ages birth up to 12 years old. You can sign up in the bulletin, online, or at the Connection Center.
Men, are you ready to have some fun and paint? Well, not really painting, but paintballing. Men Up will be going paintballing on Saturday, May 6th from 10 till noon. The cost is $25, and this includes all equipment plus 200 paintballs. Church fans are going to be leaving the church at 9:30. Pay through the offering. Be sure and write paintball on your envelope, or you can sign up at the Connection Center.
Graduation Recognition Day is Sunday, May 21st in our 11 a.m. service. If you are a graduating senior in high school, a college or tech school graduate, we want to celebrate you. You can pick up the information packet at the Connection Center today after service. We need all pictures turned in by next Sunday, May 7th. Congratulations, class of 2017.
Thanks for joining us today. If you need prayer, or if you just need someone to talk to, please visit our Life Room after service. For more information about anything here at Cornerstone, visit us online at the Connection Center or on social media.
All right, before we leave, we need everybody to stand up to your feet one more time. Come on, put those hands together. We want to leave this place declaring the goodness of God. So I want you guys to help me sing. Through you, I can do anything. I can do all things. For if you have a great week. We'll see you this Wednesday night, 7 p.m., or next Sunday at 9:30 and 11.